When we got into this thing, you wanted to fly.
The odds were all against you. It was more or less like being in death row in a penitentiary.
With the job we had was at least 50% chance of living, 50% chance of dying. We just don't want it to happen again for my grandson, my granddaughters and their husbands. I don't want to see them have to face what we did.
It's December the 20th, 1943. And in the freezing air high above Germany, Second Lieutenant Charles Charlie Brown is at the controls of his B-17F, ye old pub. Nearly the entire 8th Air Force's bomb group are headed towards Bremen to take out the Focke Wulf plant on the outskirts of the city. They can expect more than 500 FW-190s and BF-109s defending Germany. Charlie's formation is right at the front, and out behind him, strung out over 80 miles, are nearly 500 bombers. Just after 11 a.m., the pub is approaching the German border when Hugh Ecke Eckenrode cries out, "Bandits!" German fighters were attacking someone high up behind the pub. Two escorting P-47s race to intercept. The bombers push on, leaving the dogfight behind them, and at 11:30, approaching the target, flak starts to bloom all around them. The pub is rocked as four explosions go off right in front of the B-17. A cry comes across the intercom.
"We're hit!"
In the plexiglass nose, a huge hole has been made, and now icy cold wind was being blown inside. Charlie's co-pilot, Spencer Pinky Luke, told Charlie, "Engine number two was losing oil pressure." Charlie looked out the window to his left and saw that it had been hit. "Shut it down," Charlie ordered. Just 1 minute from the drop, Pinky let out an expletive as he noticed a huge hole in the right wing. Then, engine four began to rev wildly and accelerate. Charlie had been warned by his ground crew that there were problems with engine number four. What to do now? They chose to reduce power and press on through the hail of flak. Releasing their bombs over the factory, the crew turned north, planning to head over the coast, then turn west for home. With one engine out and another faulty, the pub started to fall back from the formation with another damaged plane that was trailing smoke from two engines on the left wing. Charlie heard the distress calls at lost altitude. Sam, Blackie Blackford, in the ball turret, watched as it disappeared behind and below into a cloud bank. Blackie watched, and there was an orange flash in the cloud. Something bad is happening. "Bandits!" Ecke shouted, as five BF-109s streaked from the cloud bank. Then another cry, "Bandits!" as eight FW-190s were spotted in formation ahead of the pub. Two FW-190s peeled off and headed straight towards the cockpit. Charlie nudged the pub up to meet them. Opening fire, the lead 190 hit the pub, but did little damage. Once in close, Sergeant Bertram Frenchy Coulomb in the turret shot the 190 out of the sky. The navigator, Al Doc Saddock, took out the second. Pinky reported that engine three had been hit and was now stuck on half power. That left just one engine at full power. Like sharks sensing blood in the water, five BF-109s emerged from behind the pub. Ecke cried out,
"Fighters attacking 6 o'clock level."
To their dismay, both Ecke and Blackie's guns were frozen. Hearing the shouts of his men, Brown put the injured bird into a turn. The 109s pressed their advantage and half the rudder was shot off. Charlie felt the plane judder under the impact, all the time hearing reports from the other crew members that their guns were also inoperable because of ice. The tail gunner position was hit, instantly killing Ecke. A shell penetrated and exploded near the waist gunners. Alex Russian Yelisenko had been badly hit and was losing blood. With the pub still in a tight turn, bullets tore through the cockpit, hitting the oxygen supply. The plane lurched and spun towards the ground, and Charlie and Pinky passed out. The pub fell for 4 miles. 1 mile above the fields below, Charlie started to come round. Realizing the peril and gripping the controls, he pulled back as the plane continued to fall, 5,000 feet, 4,000 feet, 3,000 feet. Just moments from hitting the earth, the plane pulled up, almost scraping the trees as it did. Passing low nearby a German airfield, the pub was heard by a pilot who was refueling and rearming his BF-109 G6. Having been in the fight already, there was an American bullet lodged in his radiator. But Franz Stigler was one bomber victory away from earning the Knight's Cross, and he wasn't going to let anything stop him. He jumped in and took off to claim his prize. Stigler rapidly caught up with the pup. Having the plane fill his sights, he was about to deliver the death blow when he realized something was wrong. The B-17 was incredibly badly damaged. The rear gunner was dead. What's more, he'd never seen a more shot-up plane still flying.
Looked at the flying wreck and sized him up and figured out how to finish it off.
Had you ever seen a bomber so badly damaged?
Not flying.
Realizing there was little threat to him, he flew around to the right wing. He could see the hole where the waste guns should be, and inside the pitiful sight of the injured crew, desperately trying to stay alive. The plane was a barely flying wreck.
I had one that couldn't walk, one that couldn't use his hands, and one with the leg bone off, and one dead.
Franz had an easy mark. He zeroed in from the rear, expecting to face the tail gunner.
And I saw him lying in there, bleeding profusely, so I couldn't shoot.
You couldn't?
No.
So I'm sitting in the cockpit alone, and I look out, and there's the world's worst nightmare sitting on my right wing. I closed my eyes, and I opened them again, and he was still there.
Did you try to shoot at him?
No, I wasn't stupid enough to try to shoot at him.
Why not?
At this point, we're totally helpless.
I saw the tail gunner wasn't there because the guns were hanging down. Half the tail was missing on the left-hand side, practically no tail at all. So, and the rudder was in the same shape. So I went up to the right side, along the fuselage. It's hard to describe if you see an airplane like that, so crippled. You know, positively, that there were badly wounded people on board. And for me, it would have been the same as shooting at a parachute. I just couldn't shoot. I went up to the right wing, right, to close by. And I saw one pilot sitting there. And after that, another one came, the co-pilot. And he looked at me, and the pilot was nicking.
I look out the right window, and there parked on my right wing is a German BF-109. The little sucker looked like he owned me and belonged there. And I was still in a little bit of a state of shock. And so I sort of closed my eyes and shook my head as you would with a nightmare. And if I close my eyes and open them again, he'll be gone. No, I opened them again and he was still there.
I waved to him, and we came out over the water, made a left-hand turn towards England. I said, right now, I hope you make it.
The code, if you will, was there.
What do you owe Franz Stigler?
My life.
That's pretty simple.
Sure is.